There's something about unity when it comes to gathering around the very presence of Jesus. We receive this presence of Jesus and we become what we receive. This is a beautiful thing. We actually don't find God. I mean, I seek the kingdom in everything I do, but my beginning of my day and the beginning of my life eternally, right? And the beginning of every day is the same. I don't find God. God finds me. That's the good news. The good news is that there's a Jesus laboring for my attention daily. The good news is from the very beginning of time, the question was never, where is God? The question was always, where is Adam? Where are you, Adam? I've come to walk with you. But we're hiding behind the bushes in our unworthiness. But our unworthiness is often a disguise of our need for control. We hide behind the bushes in our unworthiness, and Jesus, God, comes into the garden, and the question is never, where is God? The question is always, where are you, Jason? I've come to walk with you. This is how we started the night. Lord, let every table become an altar to us. That everywhere we go, may we break the bread and pour the wine. Let our hearts come alive every day. And that's the King of Glory, where every stranger has a story, right? And everywhere you go, you see strangers all the time. But you don't know sometimes whether, I don't know if God came and I didn't recognize him because he'll come in the form of a stranger. Whenever God speaks to you, it generally is strange. It's not something you've ever heard before. The grace that he brings to our life, even his presence when he came and his own didn't receive him. If the word of the Lord is never strange to you, you're probably not hearing the word of the Lord. You're probably just hearing something that you think is God's word. If Jesus' voice never speaks to me in a voice radically opposed to my own voice, it's probably not his voice, it's probably my voice. It's like Blaise Pascal said, God made man in his image and then man returned the favor. We turn our back to the sun and then the sun casts an image of ourself on the opposite horizon and we think it's God. But it's really just a shadow of ourselves. This isn't just like a hard, this is a good word. I'm about ready to tell you a good word tonight. Seriously, this is going to be a good word. It's not a hard word, I'm just setting it up so you... Jesus is not the one absent. We have every reason. We will shout your name. Why? Because we just said, you're in God. You're opening my eyes to how big your glory is. Yeah. Abraham Joshua Heschel said it this way. The glory of the Lord fills the earth. But life becomes routine. Even religion becomes routine. And routine is resistance to wonder. The issue's never been God. God's present. Lord, awaken me in such a way, train my eyes so that I can see you. Yes. It's not just like you take the magic pill and all of a sudden you start seeing. It takes time. It takes training. It's like I was up in Minnesota. These boys took me, the Theo boys, you guys know them, and they took us out carp hunting with bow and arrows, me and Sam, right? And we're out there carp hunting, and I couldn't see a thing. But I wanted to, I was just, the Lord, like, totally, like, the Lord totally blessed me. Because I've been telling my son that I wasn't much into violence. You know, violent video game. I don't like violence. I don't like shooting all these games, you know, shoot everything. I'm like, come on, let's use our imagination or something other than shooting things, you know? And so... we had just been having this dialogue that I thought was an important dialogue to have. Like, can we do something else other than shoot things? And so we get to this meeting, and these guys up in Minnesota, Adam knows them, man. They, like, kill all their own food. They make it. I mean, they're like men's men. I mean, you know what I mean? They come out of the womb, the boys, with that hair on their chest. It's like, and they're like, they build, oh yeah, we built this house, and then we built this whole sanctuary that you're worshiping in. It's like big old, huge, massive beans, and then, yeah, there's nothing, you know? Hey, would you like to go run 15 miles with me? I'm going to run this morning before I go build another house. But this is the way they are, you know? This is the way they are, seriously. And so I'm sitting, they decide to take us out for a meal, which they never do, because they kill their own food. But we have a city boy here, so let's take him out to dinner. That's what it felt like, actually. And so they take us out to this beautiful place to eat, and we're in the middle of eating, and they say, so Sam, do you hunt? And Sam says, no, my dad hates violence. And it's not even appropriate for me to tell you what I felt like at that moment. But I'm sitting there at the table, and they're all looking at me like, what? So what happened? So the next day, they're like, well, tomorrow, we're going to take you out hunting anyway. And we're going to give your dad a bow and arrow. So there I am on that boat, and we're up there high on the little thing, and we're going, and then this Tarzan, one of the sons is like Tarzan. He whips off all his stuff and gets down to his, you know, whatever. And then he jumps into the water and goes up on the shore. And he's just like going through with this cane-like thing. And he's like, I'm going to send them out to you. You all shoot them. I couldn't. It was unbelievable. He's in this marshy area just going through the water like Tarzan. Just, and now he's just showing off. Sam's like, this guy's amazing. So I got this bow and arrow. If you've ever used one of those, the tension is quite difficult to pull back. It's not just easy. So I just held it. Once I got it back, I just held it. And I'm just up there, and they're like, there's one, there's one, there's one. Did you see it? I didn't see anything, I just let it go. I just let the arrow go, and they'll tell you the story. If anybody goes up there today, they still tell the story, that arrow went straight through that carp. A 3-pound carp just went straight through it. It was a complete blessing of God. They're like, you hit it. I'm like, reel it in. So I'm reeling this thing in. And we get it in, and my son is like, you can't believe it, Sam. He's like, Dad, you're amazing. I didn't see a thing. I never saw another carp the rest of the day. I could have killed somebody. Seriously. I just let it go. Total luck. But I realized that I do see things. I see things that lots of people don't see. I'll be looking at my children and they'll say something. I'll hear them. And I see them. I see things that they do and I hear things that they say. And immediately the kingdom comes alive to me. Why? Because I've trained myself. These boys, they've been doing it since they were little kids. They never missed a carp. I couldn't see one. It was just luck of the draw. It was like God just saying, I know, you're trying to teach your son about hating violence. So I'm just going to help you out, buddy. Samuel, you see, but you can't just become a carp hunter overnight. The kingdom isn't just something that you just get a magic prayer and all of a sudden you can see it. Lord, train our eyes. Raise us from young ages. Lord, raise up even among our culture, in our children, poets again. What do I mean by that? Where we're training them that you don't have to, everything you say doesn't have to be understood right away. How are we going to raise up a generation of poets and prophets in the world if every time our children speak, you have to understand what they're saying? It takes, you get what I'm saying? You got to raise people to the trade. We don't find God. This is the beauty of it. God finds us. Who do we find? We find ourselves eventually. Hopefully. And when we do, we find the one who found us long before we could find the love ourselves. Right? That's the beauty and the good news of Jesus. Listen to this. God is present to places in you that you were not even present to yet yourself. God is present to places in me that I'm not even present to yet myself. God's present to you in places that you're not even present to yet yourself. You are on a journey with Jesus. You are becoming. I've told you guys, I know before, the stories of my time with the blind Jesuit priest, haven't I? You guys have heard that before, huh? No. Well, this blind Jesuit priest named Father Larry Gillick. And I only say that he's blind just because, guys, it seems that there are some things that only blind people can see when you're around him. He's been blind since he was 8 years old. But yet when he speaks like one that never misses a sunset. Never goes to bed before the sun, you know, set. Never misses a sunrise. Wakes up every morning just staring at the darkness until he sees the light. He speaks. When you listen to Father Larry Gillick, he speaks like someone who never misses the changing of a season. He talks in such a way that when you're listening to him, he almost like makes me realize how much routine I even have in my own life that I actually miss the wonder all around me. And he hears better than anyone I've ever known. And maybe it's because he's been blind his whole life that he hears. Maybe it's because he leads all these silent retreats and he spends so much of his life as a Jesuit in silence. You know, you do start to hear differently when you spend moments in silence. One time I heard him talking and he said, I mean, this is a man of wonder. He said, yeah, today I was just giggling to myself listening to a goose singing. He had my attention. That was so random. I was giggling to myself just listening to a goose singing, and I thought to myself, because you know, a goose sounds wonderful if you're a goose. I thought, man, this guy's got my heart. He doesn't even miss a goose singing. And he says this, and he says this, he says, it doesn't sound like an Oriole. It takes a lot of listening to know what an Oriole sounds like. You get what I'm saying? And I thought, well, I don't even know what an Oriole sounds like. That's amazing. It doesn't sound like an Oriole. It doesn't sound like a robin. And that's the beauty of it. Because beauty is distinguished by its peculiarity. So I just want you to just raise your hands like this. And I just want you to receive that from Jesus. It's the peculiarity of your life that's the beauty of your life. Creativity is not formulaic. God is not a press. He's not a machine who could care less about you. The Bible says he's a potter who shapes and forms you with his hands. This is what I was saying earlier. We are shaped and formed by the hands of God. No height nor depth can separate us. Why? Because even when you're running and moving away from him, like Jonah when you run, he uses your movement away from him and references your resistance and shapes and forms you like a potter would. As you move away, he reverences that resistance and uses it as a tool to shape and form you in your particular, peculiar shape and flow. This is the beauty of the gospel of Jesus. This is not a formula. When I was young, I wanted God to be a machine. I wanted everybody, right? I wanted God to just, I had this idea that, man, wouldn't it be great if God would just rip open the skies once a month and just tell everybody to behave. And then we'd all behave for like, you know, just like we sometimes have to resort to that in our bad parenting moments. Hey, I'm your dad and I said, stop it. Praise God. But God doesn't do that. God doesn't rip open the heavens and say, although sometimes I still think it'd be great if he just, you know, especially right now in our world, he just come down and, you know, I can't say. But we can use one. This is the point. He doesn't do that. He's not a press. He's not a machine that could care less about his creation. He doesn't just forge you, yeah. Right? Yeah. You're not just on the, we are not just on the big assembly line of God. Yeah. Just another human, another human. He doesn't even do that with our kids. Samuel comes along, another Upton, another Upton. That'd be so easy, wouldn't it? Oh, yeah, I know how to do this with Emma. It's just like with Samuel. It's not just like with Samuel. I have to be awake. Let my heart be awake. Be awake. Awaken my heart to what awakens yours, Lord. God is shaping and forming your life. You're on the wheel of God. Esther, he is laboring for you and me. Don't ever forget that the very peculiar thing that you might even be embarrassed about your life may very well be the thing that God's the most proud of. You're trying so hard to fit into the formula that you're missing the thing that makes you beautiful. We're shaped and formed by the hand of God. We were held long before we could hold on. We were loved long before we even knew how to love. We're found by God long before we can find God. And even like Jonah, even when we run from our calling, we'll end up running right into it. I told you this before, but I was having, it's just good for this particular thought, but I was having a Bible study because my father-in-law is amazing. Takes all 17 grandchildren in the summer out on Bible studies every week. So I wanted to have a Bible study with Emma because I was kind of jealous. So I memorized the story of Adam and Eve, and I wasn't going to get into the, you know, the bad stuff, you know. I just was talking about, like, how they were created, and so I'm like, oh, this is how they're created, and God wanted, you know, man didn't want, you know, to be alone, and God created Adam, and God created Eve, and I'm telling her the story, and all of a sudden she looks at me eating pancakes, and she says, Dad, this is a sad story. She was just 8 and a half. I said, No, I'm not talking about that part, Emma. I'm talking about this other part here. Well, still, she said it again. Dad, this is a sad story. I said, well, why do you think it's sad, Emma? She said, don't you think it's sad that they never got to be kids? You mean they just had to start out as adults?
That's
thought to myself, who's taking who on the bus? Right? I went to seminary. Nobody ever said that to me. So I Googled it. I looked it up. I was thinking, has anybody ever said that? Nobody's ever said that. Just Emma. In her peculiar nature, with her beautiful observation and prophetic heart. I just think it sounds terribly sad. It wasn't until years later, studying, that I actually found this out. That St. Irenaeus, he actually wrote many of our creeds and a lot of our foundational doctrines. He said this. He always depicted Adam and Eve as starting out as infants. It's true. And his reason was not the least that they need to grow into being fully human rather than starting out perfect. So he always depicted them as starting out as infants. And there's nothing theologically wrong with doing it. We just assume that they started out as full-grown adults. They must grow from being children into, instead of we just, and Adam and Eve, and they're perfect. Gregory of Nyssa, another great writer, he said, an important father of the faith says this, he's famous for saying, sin, quote, sin happens whenever we refuse to keep growing. I don't know if anybody's seen this movie, The Walk, that they made after this guy, crazy, awesome, crazy guy, that decides when they're building the Twin Towers in New York City in the 70s, he decides he sees it, and he's like, I want to walk a wire between those things. The only problem is he doesn't know how to walk a wire, so he has to go get training. Like, that's a dreamer. He doesn't even know how to walk on a wire, but this is where he's going to start. I think I'm going to start there. So he goes and he literally runs down this man named Rudy. Papa Rudy calls him in the film. Because he wants to learn how to walk the wire. And he's walking the wire and he's such a, like many of us young guys, he's just so arrogant. He's just all the dancing across the wire, you know what I mean? And he falls in the middle of his training. And this way, it's amazing in the film. You ought to watch it. Papa Rudy gets really upset at Philippe, and he says, most wire walkers die when they think they've arrived. It's important for us to realize that growing is not our enemy. Failure is not our enemy. Falling is not our enemy. Being okay at something isn't our enemy. How are you ever going to be great at something if you're never okay at it? The fear of being okay at something is often our enemy. The fear of falling is often our enemy. But falling's not our enemy. Arrival is our enemy. Well, I said the words, Jesus, love you, want to follow you all the days of my life. And you be Lord of my life. The end. Gross. No, I want to take the journey with you. Growth is an essential part living. Even the universe grows. Did you know that? I found that out from my kids. Most scientists believe that the universe will grow for eternity. And when God wanted to show the world what he was like, came in the form of a baby and he grew into a man. He learned to learn and to listen, just like all of us, and to mimic, and to talk, and to walk. The Bible says he learned to obey and to fail. He learned how to fail, guys. And he learned how to lose. I like to tell my children, Samuel, he just turned 16 this year. Samuel, Jesus was 16 once. God was 16 once. Samuel, James, he knows exactly what it feels like. Jesus knows exactly what it feels like to be 16. Emma, Jesus knows exactly. God was 14 once. He knows exactly what it feels like to be 14. Everything you go through this year, he can literally empathize with you. Lucy, God was 9 once. Oliver, God was 7 once. This is going to sound controversial, but through the Son, Jesus, even God grows. Even God grows. I was taking my daughter Lucy out and trying to, one day, this was years ago, teaching her how to write in cursive the word love. And so, you know, on those sheets, you like show her, she's working on her cursive writing. So she's writing the word love. And I'm drinking coffee and reading a book, and she's sitting there doing, working on love. And so she's writing the word love, writing the word love. She must have written it 30, 40 times. And all of a sudden, she grabs me, get my attention, as if she'd found this amazing thing, and she did. She said, "Hey, Daddy, look, love's got a hole in it." It took me a second to see what she saw. And finally, I saw that O. I said, "Look at that, Lucy. Love does got a hole in it." And I thought to myself, man, just being a songwriter, I thought, that'd be an amazing country song. I said, love's got a hole in it. And the more I thought about it, the more that hole became a circle. Love tells the whole story. Love fosters growth in your life. Love lets us journey far from Eden and find our way back home again. Love is poetry more than it's prose. Like the great poet David White says about poetry, once poetry has said what it has to say, you can walk away from it. You can turn and walk away from it. But when you turn your face back again, it will still be waiting for you. And here's this beautiful passage. Luke 22:31-32. It's going to seem odd, but just stick with me and I'll be done in about 6 minutes. Okay? And the Lord said, "Simon, Simon." I love that because Jesus goes back to his beginning. He doesn't call him Peter at this moment. He could have. He specifically called him Simon, and he says it twice. "Simon, Simon, Satan has come and asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith will not fail. And when you have returned to me, you'll strengthen your brothers." And I just want us to just think about for just a moment where Peter, Simon Peter, his journey began. And just remember. His journey begins with Jesus because he'd heard about this Jesus, this we think he's the Messiah, from his family members. All of a sudden, Jesus comes and there's a big old crowd that he's going to preach to, remember, on the seashore. And they're crowding in on him to such a degree that he needs to get out in the water. So he gets himself out in the water by use of Peter's boat. And the reason he could use Peter's boat was because Peter wasn't catching fish. They'd been out fishing, catching no fish. So they brought the boats in, and there the boats are in, and it's almost as if Peter, I'm using my imagination, it's almost as though Peter's saying, hey, we're not catching fish anyway, might as well use it for something. So Jesus uses Peter's boat, he goes out into the water, and he preaches from the boat to the shore. And he finishes up preaching, and as if to say thank you to Peter, he says, hey, why don't you guys... We weren't catching any fish. Why don't you just cast your nets on the other side of the boat? And they cast their net on the other side of the boat, and they catch such a haul of fish, it's breaking the nets. And Peter says, Lord, Lord, get away from me. I'm unworthy. Now, this is the power of the gospel. Peter says, get away from me. I'm unworthy. And Jesus says, no. Come closer. I actually want to walk with you. I want you, and I want you to be with me. We're going to spend time together this next several years, and you're going to become. I'm going to set you on the wheel, and we're going to start shaping and forming, Peter, and you're going to become. You're going to go full circle, right? That's what he's saying. You're coming along with me. You journey with me into a life of becoming, Peter. No, I'm unworthy. Hide behind the bushes. No, you come with me. Come follow me. Now, there's such a journey when you watch Peter, right? But this passage is right in the center of Peter. You know, he's always arguing with Jesus, telling Jesus what he should be doing. And this passage is right in the middle of a portion of Scripture where Peter is literally denying that he would ever do what Jesus said he's going to do. And what happens? Jesus says, Simon, Simon, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you. That your faith will not fail. And when you have returned to me, you'll strengthen your brothers. So what happens? You know what happens? There's a coal fire. And Peter does exactly what Jesus said, you know? Exactly, actually not even what Jesus said. He does exactly what he said that he wouldn't do. And then you know what happens. And then Peter finds himself back to just fishing again after Jesus', you know, death and resurrection. So he's out there fishing. Undoubtedly feeling condemnation, guilt, remorse, regret. And what happens? It's not just coincidence, guys. Because love's got a hole in it. They're not catching any fish again. It's also not coincidence that there's only two coal fires in the Bible. The one when Peter denies Jesus and the one on the beach right now in this passage of John 21. And there Jesus, it's like he sets up the scene, right? Like being with Rachel in St. Augustine where we dated and fell in love. Every time we go to St. Augustine, I smell the air and I fall right back in love with Rachel. I can smell it. It brings my memories back to the beginning moments with her, holding her hand for the very first time. Peter, he Jesus puts a coal fire to bring back the memory. And then he calls to the disciples and says, hey, boys, why don't you cast your nets on the other side? Almost as if to say it's okay. This is something. Peter doesn't even recognize Jesus' voice. It's right there in the text. John does. I honestly believe sometimes we can miss the wonder and glory in the voice of Jesus when we feel so much condemnation. When you start to feel guilt, when you start to feel regret, when you start to feel remorse, when you feel like you're not on the journey or you missed the shaping or something happened, all of a sudden you can't even hear Jesus calling out to you and your children anymore. And there he is. He's out there feeling sad and sorry, and Jesus calls out his name and he doesn't even recognize his voice anymore, but John does, the Bible says. And John says, hey, Peter, that's Jesus. The moment Peter realizes it's Jesus, the Bible says that he doesn't just walk on the water. This is what I love, guys. He jumps in the water. And he swims to shore. And he stands before Jesus and he's reinstated. And what happens? Do you love me? Feed my sheep. Strengthen your brothers. Now, if you read the passage that we read tonight, the editors do a good job. They give us like verses. That's a good thing. You know, editors in the Bible, you know, 32, 31, 21. And they give us little things. This is what this passage is. Well, this passage, you won't find a Bible that's been edited that won't give us a title that says, Jesus Predicts Peter's Denial. It always says, Jesus predicts Peter's denial. And I'm not arguing that he's predicting Jesus' denial. I'm just saying he's predicting a lot more than Peter's denial. Something much more beautiful is happening than Jesus predicting Peter's denial. Jesus is predicting Peter's return. This is what he's saying. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you that your faith will not fail. And when, never if, when you have returned to me, you will strengthen your brothers. Peter, Simon, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you. Isn't that what you want to hear from Jesus? Isn't that what you want to hear from your brothers and sisters? Isn't that what you want to hear from your dad? Isn't that what you want to hear from your mom? Isn't that what we could be as the church? Are we a people that pray that the faith of those that journey will not fail? Or are we a people that hope that their faith fails because we're so wounded by their leaving? What kind of people have we become? Are we partaking of the bread and the wine and becoming the Jesus we're partaking of?
Good question.
You're a poet and you journey a little bit. Woo! That's the problem becoming a poet, because poets are circular, man. I've gotten so much trouble early on being a poet because you know why? Because the development of a poet is you go out here and you get about 3 o'clock and the clock down, you know what I mean? And you never find your way back again. But linears, they never get in trouble. Their lines are just short or long. And this is the beauty of it. Linears are wonderful. The reward of the linear thinker is that they're understood quickly. The reward of the poet is not being understood. The reward of the, but they do get a reward, guys. The reward of the poet. How many of you are poets in your thinking, your cycles in here? Artists, the way you think, your journey. Raise your hands. Those poetry sections at Barnes & Noble are getting small, guys. It speaks to our culture. Keep your hands raised. They're getting small. But it's not because we don't have a need for you. The reward of the circular thinker is mystery. Friendship with God. It's not being understood quickly. That's the reward. Lord, give them their reward. In Jesus' name. Give them their reward. And I pray that you will never make sacrament the judgments that have been spoken over you. You know what I mean by that? That you will not eat them or partake of those things and then become what you've partaken. That you will not partake of the judgment over your life. That you will not partake of words that have cursed your life and become and make those words that are spoken over you like they're words falling from heaven. Jesus has come down from heaven. The Bible says in Isaiah that you have come down from heaven like the water into the earth, like seeds from heaven you've fallen. You will not go back up until you've succeeded in what he sent you to do.
Amen.
What kind of people have we become? Are we like Jesus? I know it's going to sound funny, and it's only funny in a non-Catholic environment. But I went to go see a priest, Father Donahue, and I was talking to him about this very thing. Man, it's sort of harsh out there following Jesus, man. People get mad about things. It's just inside. Because we all have our shadow images of Jesus, don't we? This is Jesus. He said, yeah. And this, I want you to understand, this is a Catholic priest in our day, right now, living, alive, right here, right now. This is unbelievable for him to say this. He looks at me and he says, Jason, I know, I just had a man that I've been giving direction to for 48 years walk into my office this week and told me, crying, Father Donahue, my son has lost his faith. He said, Jason, it took me 15 minutes to realize that his son had just become a Methodist. Do you understand? That's funny to us. It's not funny if you're Catholic. That's amazing for him to say that. He says, I'm not going to pray for you that your son will come back to your faith. He has not lost his faith. He's just lost your faith. This is what we're going to pray. We're going to pray that he finds his faith because Jesus is walking with him. He's on the journey with the Lord. He's being shaped and formed by the hands of God. He's not lost his faith just because he became a Methodist. Worship. I woke up this morning and I saw a ship out in the harbor. And I saw a warrior on the shore. Jesus has been laboring for you long before you even knew what labor was. Jesus has been warring for your life and your children's life and a generation's life and Norfolk's life. More than we could ever war and battle and fight. There's a ship out at sea and there's a warrior on the shore and he's calling out our names. This is a gospel and this is a God who labors for us more than we'd ever labor for ourselves. And your life is a life worthy of that kind of labor. And then what does Jesus say? I want you to become like that to the world around you. I want your worship to war like I've warred for you. I want you to war for others. Hey, Simon, Simon, Jason, Jason, Rachel, Rachel. Satan's asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But guess what? Good news. I have prayed for you. That your faith will not fail. And when you have returned, you'll strengthen your brothers. So let us sing the song of Jesus. Let us sing the song of him. What was sung in the beginning, we'll be singing in the end. Why? Because of what we just heard. Let us sing the song of Jesus. There is hope in the refrain. For we all, not just Adam and Eve, it's not just Peter, it's not just Jacob, it's not just Jonah. We all have left the garden, and we will all return again. Let us sing the song of Jesus. It's a song of the redeemed, and the mercy that saved us is the mercy that we need today. Let us sing the song of Jesus, and let it burn just like a flame, and let it light a fire in every heart that hears our Savior's name. It's a song that calls you by your name, Simon, Simon, Jason. It's a song that leads us home again, and there is no greater love than